Hey, thank you so much for that wonderful introduction, Sarah. My name is Dr. Neville, and we will get started here. I have a ton of information for everyone. I'm going to be efficient as I move through these slides. You'll find a lot of citations, a lot of controlled trials to back up the information here. So you will have access to these slides as well as the audio presentation from here on out. So if you're overwhelmed, not to worry, you'll have this on record and you'll be able to go back and refer to it. So let's get started here. Okay, so today's presentation is going to be based on achieving hormone balance without hormone replacement. So a lot of our focus here at Labrix is in the realm of bioidentical hormone replacement, but that's not to say that alternative approaches are not as valid and applicable. We have providers from around the world who sometimes don't actually have access to bioidentical hormones. Some providers just simply prefer to approach things in a more conservative manner. And so a lot of physicians and providers are using both these foundational aspects and BHRT or bioidentical hormone replacement. So if any of that speaks to you, this information will be quite valuable. Okay, so these are all of the symptoms that we're trying to manage here. It's a laundry list of symptoms, right? So we're going to break this up into, first we'll talk about the menopausal symptoms, and then we're going to move on to premenopausal symptoms. So breaking that up into PMS and PCOS. So again, you know, negative aspect here is that there are so many symptoms that we're trying to manage for our patients. But the good news is if we do approach this from a foundational aspect, we are addressing so many of these symptoms at the same time in that hormone realm. Okay, so first off, the causes of hormone imbalance. Important to remember these etiologies because this hints to possible treatment options. I won't spend too much time on this slide, but to list a few here, stress definitely plays a part. Nutritional deficiencies, maybe poor gastrointestinal function or liver function, and then this idea of receptor site function. So we can oftentimes measure the hormones themselves and that those levels, but we can't often understand what's going on at the receptor function site. So we'll talk a bit about that today. So treatment overview, here's all the things that I'll be going through with you as far as menopause, premenopause, PMS, PCOS, all of these things. You'll see the first four here, diet, exercise, stress management, and sleep optimization. These are really considered the foundations to health, right? These are universal to all beings. We need to manage this. If any of those aspects are out of balance, we can use, you know, and throw all the nutraceuticals and botanicals at this, but we're really battling uphill. So I think it's easy to overlook these first four things, but really they're really the foundations. And then the nutraceutical and botanical treatments are really the cherries on top to our treatments. Okay, so we'll start out talking about menopause. So the definition here is the last spontaneous menstrual period 12 months prior. That's really when you can define menopause. The average age of onset is 51 years. And perimenopause, this transition is actually quite long, sometimes lasting up to even 10 years. This slide talks about 3 to 7 years, which is average. And here's the interesting aspect here is that the longer that women are living, the more that we really need to focus in this area. So today's average woman can expect to live at least 1/3 of her life in this postmenopausal stage. So that's so imperative that we have an arsenal of ways to support these women. So there are hormone receptors all throughout the body, not just in the breast and the uterine tissues as we're often focusing on. So it's not surprising why a drop in hormones during menopausal transition, postmenopausally, we see such systemic symptoms. So we're talking about skin, bone, vascular lining. We're talking about teeth, gums, eyes, the brain, the central nervous system, right? It's not surprising why there's so many symptoms. And then sex steroids often affect sleep. They affect libido. They affect brain health, pain sensitivity, all of these things, depression and mood. So thus, again, just another reason why we need a lot of tools at our disposal. So conventional treatment of menopausal symptoms usually consists of estrogen replacement therapy. It is well known that if you're using estrogen replacement therapy and the woman still has an intact uterus, that you want to combine that with a progestin or a progesterone. That's to prevent estrogen-induced endometrial hyperplasia, basically the precursor to uterine cancer. So that's the conventional thinking on that. 75% of women experience hot flashes, at least at some point during that menopausal transition. It's one of the most common complaints in clinical practice. And the mechanism of this is actually not fully understood. There are some theories, one of which is explained here on this slide. And we're talking about diminished levels of estrogen and progesterone. They have a direct effect on the hypothalamus. So that's the part of the brain that controls appetite, controls sleep cycles, sex hormones, and body temperature. So basically this drop in hormones causes the hypothalamus to read, you know, too hot quite often, especially at night. And then we have this release of norepinephrine, epinephrine, prostaglandins, and this causes the heart to pump faster, the blood vessels in the skin to dilate, and that's in that attempt to cool the body. So interestingly here, we have some research suggesting that lifestyle factors may play a bigger role in menopausal symptoms than we previously thought. So 1970, there was an anthropologist who studied women in India, and she found actually that most complained of no symptoms during menopause other than menstrual changes. A decade later, we have Margaret Locke. She studied Japanese women. They reported shoulder stiffness and hot flashes were actually quite rare. And then in Hong Kong, there were researchers looking into the same issue. They looked at joint and you know, had joint and muscle problems reported. And in fact, all of those symptoms were reported as mild. So this really may allude to the hormonal impact of our lifestyle, perhaps how we eat, how we sleep, how we manage stress, how we move our bodies, how we live our lives very differently than some of the women in this study. So the next four slides here are all on the subject of diet. So spoiler alert, I'm going to place high importance on this foundational aspect. And then potentially one could start here and build upon therapies from there on out. The first slide here is talking about soy. So this is a controversial topic. There are many controlled trials that have found consumption of soy protein, so isoflavin-rich soy protein or supplements significantly decrease the frequency and severity of hot flashes. So that's the majority. There are, again, many of them. There are a few that actually showed a negative aspect or did not, or were equivocal and did not show improvement. So the clinical trials were using somewhere between 50 and 120 milligrams of soy for anywhere from 6 weeks to 6 months. There were other studies using somewhere between 20 and 60 grams for 6 to 12 weeks. And then one study, they actually used a much larger dose. They were using 200 milligrams a day, and that was for 2 years. They actually showed that that treatment was significantly less effective than placebo. So there may be this therapeutic window in treatment. So we're unlikely to resolve, you know, the controversy today, but know that the research continues and this soy story is ongoing. One caution here, there was a study showing a long-term treatment of 5 years, they actually found that endometrial hyperplasia was being reported in the soy consumers at 3.9% of the women in the study. So something to keep an eye on. It's something that you may want to, look into that and have that test done. Make sure that endometrial hyperplasia is not occurring. So here's a very large study in the dietary realm. So these were women not on hormone therapy. 40% were assigned to a low-fat program with increased fruits and vegetables and whole grains, and then the others ate a customary diet. So women in the diet group were 14% more likely to eliminate the menopausal symptoms. And then in fact, the dieting women were three times more likely to lose weight. Even the women who gained weight still were more likely to reduce their symptoms. And then the American Journal of Clinical Nutrition has a study here of 6,000 women. They were followed for 9 years, and those that were eating a Mediterranean diet were 20% less likely to report hot flashes and night sweats. Those that were eating that non-Mediterranean diet, so they were higher in fat and sugar, were 20% more likely to develop hot flashes and night sweats. So diet is something that's hard to study, but I think we can all agree that an individualized approach is likely best. Common themes to this that we can see from those studies are whole and natural unprocessed foods, an emphasis on vegetables, whole grains, beans, seeds, nuts, fruits, right? Limiting simple carbohydrates, limiting fried foods, alcohol, sugar, salt can all have an impact. In addition to that, I'm adding a couple things here in this dietary realm. So flaxseed in particular has been studied to have a beneficial effect on menopause symptoms. And this is likely due to the content of lignans, especially with that freshly ground flaxseed lignans are released. And this is thought to modulate the metabolism of the estrogens into their less carcinogenic metabolites. Fiber and brassica vegetables also have been shown to do this. So just another reason to suggest increasing fruits and vegetables. And then weight control. So managing weight may help to decrease the frequency of hot flashes. There's also this idea that being too thin may actually worsen the symptoms, because body fat becomes actually an important site of estrogen during the menopausal years. Once ovulation isn't occurring, estrogen is not produced from the ovaries, so it's actually coming from the peripheral tissue, and it's coming from that fat tissue. So like many things in medicine, it's that Goldilocks story, right? We want weight in the correct zone, not too high, not too low. So exercise can help to deter hot flashes. Women who work out report that they generally get fewer episodes of hot flashes than sedentary women. A theory here is that exercise raises endorphin levels, and that may be helping to modulate. Not coincidentally, it shows that endorphin levels are involved in the regulation of body temperature. So perhaps the higher the endorphin levels, the more reliable that thermostat of the body might be. Generally, we try to avoid exercise within 3 hours of going to bed, because there are reports of that increasing night sweats. So there's probably not one aspect of health that exercise does not touch on. In my practice, I'm starting to use the word body movement and trying to steer away from exercise. I feel like exercise sometimes is kind of a trigger word. Patients want to move away from that and avoid it at all costs. But body movement feels more natural. It feels like something that we understand, we can work into our daily life in multiple variants, not just like one 30-minute session, but throughout the day. So we see here relief from hot flashes, a decrease in bone loss, improved heart function, improved circulation. Very important here, this improved ability to deal with stress. I think that's a very large part of what's going on here. And then increased self-esteem, mood and frame of mind. This part is very important here, because women they feel and they report feeling invisible in these years. I think, you know, that reporting of feeling invisible is such a devastating part of this whole of this whole transition. So I really focus in that area, and I think that's a larger part than we than at first glance. So stress management, anxiety is strongly correlated with hot flashes. When I first read this, I assumed, you know, that the hot flashes were creating anxiety and this was the correlation here. But this study actually found that anxiety preceded the hot flashes. So the women in the study with the highest stress levels were 5 times more likely to report hot flashes than women with normal stress levels. So here's a list of stress management tools that you might find helpful. You know, patients, by all means, they don't need to do all of these things, but perhaps picking 2 or 3 that they resonate with. Women are tend to be the I do it all types, right? Like sometimes supporting elderly parents, children, grandchildren, they may still be working. They're kind of everything to everyone around them. And it's often said that you cannot pour from an empty cup, right? Like our patients can't give unless they're taken care of first. So, you know, asking them to pick, you know, 2 or 3 things on here that they may resonate with again, and making sure that this is a part of their life. We have a growing body of research to show that meditation can help improve objective health markers, things like blood pressure. So reminding our patients of this mindfulness or meditation, not necessarily a new age spiritual treatment, but a direct medical treatment, and should be thought of as such, just like a prescription medication. So there are some wonderful apps here. If you're not familiar with them, I've listed them under the meditation bullet point there. Headspace is one that seems to be a favorite among my patients, but also there's Hello Mind. And those are guided meditation apps so that patients who are new to this don't feel kind of lost with their minds that won't shut down, but they can be guided through this. Okay, so here's a study on mindfulness training and hot flashes. This study was small. It was about 110 people, but significant nonetheless. The frequency of hot flashes decreased by an average of 39%. The severity decreased by 40%, and that was over the course of 11 weeks. So there was a 28% improvement in overall quality of life. So what's better than that? Most women saying that they were better able to cope with their hot flashes after the stress reduction program. So here, everyone, this is my favorite slide of the entire presentation. I almost get a little teary-eyed when I read this. I'll skip the first one here, but I'll read the second and third for you. So these were women who took part in a mindfulness meditation program. And they were postmenopausal, stating, I am more aware than ever of my own ability and responsibility to change the course of my life, to choose happiness, joy, and peace rather than waiting for someone else or fate to deliver it. And in fact, if this is midlife, I have another half ahead. That's a lot of time to use the wisdom gained in the first half to make the second half richer and more joyful. Yeah, I have goosebumps every time I read that. I think that's so powerful. And, you know, what better practice if you left, you know, your workday and your patients were saying this. I think that's just amazing. So on the subject of stress, if we need an objective measurement of stress, that's where looking into adrenal health comes in, looking at cortisol levels. This can elucidate dysregulation in that HPA axis that happens over time. So we have the adrenal testing that you can do with salivary hormones. And then treatment based on that might be lifestyle changes, stress management techniques, as we mentioned, but also B vitamins, especially B5 and B6, vitamin C, and then adaptogenic botanicals of all sorts. There are so many, but ashwagandha and holy basil are just a couple of examples. And then using phosphorylated serine for salivary cortisol levels that are actually elevated. Oftentimes that's right before bed that's happening. So that's where that can be used. And then maybe a little obvious here, but trigger avoidance. Patients usually know of these right away, but sometimes good to remind them in case they're not making that connection. So diet pills, stress, hot tubs, saunas, hot showers, hot beds, hot rooms, anything hot, hot weather, and smoking can all trigger and exacerbate those hot flashes. And then there's a connection here between hormone imbalance and neurotransmitters. In the United States, there's a pharmaceutical SSRI called Bridesdale. It's actually approved to manage hot flashes. Clinical trials show reduced frequency of hot flashes by 57 to 59%. And those were studied in women with at least 7 hot flashes per day. So we might wonder if the SSRI would be effective in more mild cases, perhaps. Interestingly here, the dosage used was much lower than what's used to typically treat depression. And then also another interesting point here, those that were receiving placebo in this study actually reported a reduction in hot flashes between 40 and 48%. So quite high there as well. So we see that there's this connection, the use of SSRIs seemingly to reduce hot flashes might elucidate checking in on neurotransmitter levels and seeing if we could utilize things like 5-HTP, for instance, tryptophan, something of that nature to regulate serotonin and neurotransmitter levels as well. So there is a neurohormone complete and a complete plus panel that can look into hormones and neurotransmitters for you if you're interested in that. And then the hormone cascade. So important to remember where these steroid hormones are coming from in the first place, and cholesterol is the backbone to that entire cascade. So the liver usually being the point of origin where most of cholesterol production is coming from. There are some cholesterol coming from dietary things like meat, eggs, butter, and dairy products. But remember your patients who are on statin medications, any drug that's inhibiting the liver's production of cholesterol, you know, this hormone cascade may be quite impaired because of those medications. And so this is a nice chart you can refer back to. We have some steroid hormone cofactors involved here, and you can take a peek. A lot of B vitamins involved, zinc, vitamin A, and folate, all involved in transitioning cholesterol on down the pathway to create all of these hormones. And then let's dive into some nutraceuticals. So vitamin E has been studied and may reduce the occurrence and severity of hot flashes and night sweats. In addition, it will likely improve the immune system and protect the heart. So anytime I can, you know, do more than one thing at the same time, I like treatment programs like that or treatment protocols. Also consider evening primrose oil. It's been studied at 500 milligrams 3 times a day to improve that nighttime flushing in particular. And then also remember that with hot flashes, there's likely a lot of sweating going on, a lot of nutrient depletion. So just like with exercise, we think about replacement of electrolytes, things like vitamin C, magnesium, potassium, and B vitamins. So electrolytes and nutrients that we want to replace. Okay, and then as far as modulating estrogen itself, consider calcium D-glucarate, 500 milligrams once to twice a day. Has been shown to reduce the absorption of estrogen in the intestine, so it basically decreases circulating levels of estrogen as a whole. And then endol-3-carbinol at 500 milligrams a day, or its dimer, diendolmethane, at 300 milligrams each day or twice a day. These are compounds found in cruciferous vegetables, brassica vegetables. So these have been shown to shift the estrogen metabolism. So again, breaking down those estrogen components into their less carcinogenic metabolites. Okay. Vitamin C and flavonoids. This is a wonderful study. 94 women, they received a combination of flavonoids and vitamin C here. The dosing is listed there. Vitamin C was at 1200 milligrams. Very fascinating here. Most patients experienced some relief, and you guys may like this. This treatment appeared to be more effective than other treatments they were comparing in this study, including low-dose estrogen. Find that quite interesting. The only effect seen here was slightly offensive odor of perspiration, and that tended to discolor the clothing. So a little downside there. Most women found that to not be an issue at all because their hot flashes were decreased. They were just fine with that. And here's magnesium for hot flashes. So this is an uncontrolled trial. They used 250 to 500 milligrams a day for 4 weeks. There was a significant decrease in the frequency of hot flashes. And these were women studied that had treatment for breast cancer. So, you know, the point being with this slide, magnesium, potentially vitamin E and vitamin C, these nutraceuticals are fairly safe. They're fairly inexpensive, and they may have added benefits, you know, over and above reducing hot flashes. So those are kind of the pearls I will leave you with, is really reaching for those as a first trial so that you're not having to use maybe more expensive botanicals and using things that are inexpensive and easy to get a hold of. So here's a discussion about aromatase. So the aromatase enzyme, if you remember, converts testosterone into estrogen. So this enzyme is especially active in adipose tissue. So potentially problematic both for men and women as they age, if we're wanting to make sure that testosterone is not dropping and moving into more and more estrogen, causing more estrogen dominance, we might consider utilizing something like an aromatase inhibitor. So there are both pharmaceutical and natural aromatase inhibitors. The natural ones studied have been the flavonoids, including chrysin, resveratrol, and luteolin, and then melatonin also, actually. There was a study here by the Journal of Steroid Biochemistry. They actually found that chrysin was the most potent of all of these naturally occurring flavonoids. And I will add here, that's not on the slide, it does look like transdermal chrysin is much more effective than oral chrysin. And here is a study on melatonin as an aromatase inhibitor. So this is comparing melatonin to pharmaceutical aromatase inhibitor and seeing that as effective and as potent. So very interesting there, melatonin. And then we move here into botanicals. So first we'll talk about black cohosh. This is probably the most well-known for treating hot flashes. I'm sure you've heard of it. There are over 125 published scientific papers on this in use for perimenopause and menopause. So studies recommend somewhere between 40 and 80 milligrams each day. This can provide relief from hot flashes, but other symptom improvements too: headaches, heart palpitations, anxiety, and sleep disturbances. Sleep issues are another very, very common complaint in the menopausal years. Important to remember that 4 to 12 weeks was needed before they were seeing therapeutic benefits. So remember to counsel patients on that. Sometimes they're assuming they can replace, you know, a pharmaceutical version with a botanical, and the botanical is going to work overnight. But with root cause healing, it's oftentimes much more gradual and slow. So as long as they know that ahead of time, they'll be willing to wait with you until they feel better. Summary here, there's evidence of anti-estrogenic action in black cohosh. It does not contain phytoestrogens, should be safe for use in breast cancer patients. The study listed below, the Fritz study, is a review of black cohosh and breast cancer. So you'll have access to that to look into it. The most current thinking about the mechanism here of black cohosh is that it's acting somewhat as an SSRI, has a great safety profile. However, don't use it if there's a liver disorder. And then maca. So maca is a cruciferous root. It grows exclusively in the Peruvian Andes. There are 175 different species. And then within those species, there's many different phenotypes. So it's really important here to not assume any maca is going to help with hot flashes. There's very different physiologic effects from all of the different species and phenotypes. So make sure you're looking at the study and using the species described. Here is one. This is a randomized clinical control trial, small study, 14 menopausal women, but they used 3.5 grams per day of powdered maca. And they used that for 6 weeks. There was a significant reduction in anxiety, depression, and sexual dysfunction quite uniquely. The study appeared to be independent of the measurable effects of sex hormones or sex hormone binding globulin. So again, like we talked about in the very beginning, potentially this botanical approach is working more at that receptor site level than the actual hormone molecules themselves, you know, so not increasing them, the amount of estrogen or progesterone, but modulating the sensitivity of the receptor site. Okay. And moving on to valerian. So here's a study reporting improvement in sleep. So again, a huge complaint postmenopausally. So this was a study of 100 women. They used 530 milligrams of valerian twice a day for 4 weeks. Overall, 30% of the women reported improvement in sleep quality. And then another study using 225 milligrams three times a day also showed improvement. Siberian rhubarb is another one shown in the studies to improve, 250 milligrams per day, and this was used for 12 weeks. Significant improvement in that menopausal rating score, and then no adverse effects were seen. Another study of 363, they were using 4 milligrams of dried extract. So that's similar to that first study there. And this was used for 6 months. They saw improvement in hot flashes, improvement in irritability, sleep issues, depression, and fatigue. Okay, so let's move on. Outside of hot flashes, we'll talk about vaginal dryness here. So we need another arsenal of tools to be able to help women with this. Starting with the most simple and moving forward, hydration, making sure that adequate water intake is there. That's imperative for production of all body secretions. Some type of lubricant can often be used. Water-based lubricants may be more effective in reducing that discomfort. Kegel exercises, if you haven't recommended this before, you can look into this, but we actually are thinking this may improve circulation in that pelvic floor and help to assist in maintaining the tissue tone. Avoiding douching, avoiding soaps and bubble baths, that can actually be quite irritating to the area. Using oral probiotics can help to maintain that balanced ecosystem. Also vitamin E, that can actually be used vaginally. So insertion of a vitamin E capsule can be quite helpful. Evening primrose oil, and this is an oral dose here, that has been shown to improve vaginal dryness, and also vitamin A for its efficacy in maintaining integrity of the skin, right? Acupuncture. There are several studies in support of acupuncture as an alternative to hormone replacement therapy. It looks like it's increasing endorphin activity and may help to modulate that thermoregulation zone, keep it more stable, so decrease the kind of ups and downs that it's experiencing in the temperature control. Some studies, there was a significant decrease reported in the frequency, but not in the severity of hot flashes. So that might be what you find as well. This study showed that the acupuncture arm did not show significant changes in the hormone levels, but the hot flash severity was reduced. So again, are we working, you know, at a different mechanism there? Maybe the receptor site sensitivity as well. Okay, so here's a case study of ours. This is Pam. She was a 55-year-old postmenopausal woman. The table here is showing this is an actual report of a comprehensive hormone profile. If you haven't run these already, this is probably our most common panel. You can see that Pam has an elevated estradiol level. Her progesterone to estradiol ratio is actually low, so it's showing us, you know, not surprisingly that there's estrogen dominance here. The progesterone level, though it's within range, is still leaving room to allow that progesterone estradiol ratio be low. And then in addition to that, we actually see elevations in both testosterone and DHEA. So likely some insulin resistance present, some blood sugar dysregulation that causes an increase in those androgen levels, and then some aromatization, as we talked about before, because that testosterone level is elevated, that's probably helping to get to that elevated estradiol level. So we also see adrenal fatigue here present, HPA axis dysfunction. We consider this a phase 2 fatigue. So you'll see this looks very similar to the reports that you may be already doing. But again, we're looking at elevated androgens suggesting dysglycemia or blood sugar problems, insulin resistance being the start of all of that. So let's talk about what we can do for Pam. We placed her on a holistic treatment protocol here. We're trying to avoid triggers. She was quite symptomatic in hot flashes and night sweats, and that was her main complaint coming in. We chose a Mediterranean diet that was high in fiber, plant-based, and included ground flax seeds every day. We had her do meditation sessions. We did 15 minutes 5 times a week with the Hello Mind app. She really liked that one. And then resistance exercise. We had her do 30-minute sessions 3 times a week with a friend, right? Hitting 2 birds with 1 stone. And that resistance exercise seems to be really helpful in blood sugar and insulin receptor site sensitivity. So that's why we chose resistance exercise. We also gave her diindolmethane, 300 milligrams twice a day if she was able to do that. Some days she only got that in once a day. Vitamin D, we did 2000 IUs, and vitamin E, 600 IUs every day. We also added in evening primrose oil, 500 milligrams 3 times a day, black cohosh, and we supported that HPA axis with the B complex and ashwagandha. So let's see how she did. 6 months later, we have her report back. Her hot flashes are less in frequency and severity. She's got improved energy and clarity of mind. Her lipid profile has actually improved. I didn't include that here, but that was also run. Her blood pressure has improved. And more importantly, she reports a greater ability to manage the stressors in her life. She felt that the exercise and meditation treatments have given her new tools, which has been one of the most significant aspects for her of all of those treatments that we gave her. So we see that her estradiol level has come down significantly, so she's now within range. Her progesterone level has come up just slightly. You oftentimes postmenopausally won't see a huge shift here in that progesterone, the actual numbers, but we see that her ratio, both because progesterone has increased and estrogen has gone down, that progesterone to estradiol ratio has now normalized. So that's great. Her testosterone level remains high. However, you can see at 57.45 before and 49 now that there was a significant drop there. So, you know, this is a snapshot in time. We're likely moving towards a normal level there. And then the DHEA level has now normalized. She's still on the higher side, the upper end of that range, but much improved. And then her adrenal function as well has improved. So overall, we're very thrilled with this, and Pam is definitely a happier person. Okay, so let's move on to the premenopausal symptoms. I'm gonna try to pick things up here and go a little bit faster to get you guys all of the information here. So here is the textbook definition of PMS. I'll let you read through that. I think the next slide here is a little more telling. This one sums it up, I think, a little bit better. I think more telling, I'm sure you will agree. A lot going on in PMS. The cause is not very well understood, but we think possible factors in contribution are deficiencies of serotonin, dopamine, and hormone imbalance. also potentially this exaggerated response to normal hormone changes. So conventionally, therapy includes oral contraceptive pills, SSRIs, diuretics to reduce that bloating, and anxiolytic agents to reduce anxiety. So not surprisingly, a lot of women crave carbohydrates during that PMS time because we think there's this attempt of the body to increase serotonin, right? And consumption of carbohydrates will provide sometimes tryptophan, which will then convert to serotonin. However, you know, the studies show that increasing sugar, caffeine, and alcohol have all been associated with increasing severity of PMS. A couple studies here also showing improvement in PMS symptoms with the removal of dairy products. And then exercise. So interestingly here, we have two studies, not surprising, both aerobic exercise improved PMS symptoms and also yoga as well. The next slide here compares aerobic and strength training. So strength training, I think there's been more attention given to this lately. However, in this study at least, while both groups did improve, aerobic exercise seemed to be more helpful, especially in that depression symptom. So this is a summary of quite a few nutrients that you might consider for PMS. Now this is mostly taken from the work of Dr. John Lee. If you're not familiar with his work, I highly recommend you check out his many books, but he really paved the way for providers to treat patients without the use of synthetic hormones. He was kind of a pioneer in that area. So any of his books would be a great resource for you. He used a lot of bioidentical hormone replacement. He also used these nutrients and found high efficacy for his patients. So I've tried to put in here also the times where controlled trials are also supporting the work that he was doing. And so you'll see that all listed in this slide. We'll go into more detail as we move forward here. So I'll start with vitamin B6. So vitamin B6 may reduce some of the effects of estrogen excess, but also we're thinking because it's a cofactor involved in so many neurotransmitters, we may also, with vitamin B6, be supporting serotonin, dopamine, progesterone, and those are all thought to be low when we're dealing with PMS. So most trials show supplementation doses of somewhere between 40 to 500 milligrams per day. So that's a wide range. I'll get a little bit more detailed on the next slide. But that shows to reduce edema, bloating, headaches, breast pain, depression, irritability, and even acne flares. So huge, huge symptom approach there, which is awesome. So there are trials that are negative or equivocal when studying B6 and PMS. And interestingly, B6 levels that have been tested are actually normal usually in women with PMS. So if the vitamin's working, it's probably on more of a pharmacological mechanism. Most women you can use somewhere between 50 and 100 milligrams. They seem to do well for the most part on that. Some women don't experience any improvement. There are a subset that seem to do much better on much larger doses, especially in that week prior to menstruation. Caution here, because using doses greater than 200, there are reports of sensory neuropathy development. So if you're using that high of a dose, really keep an eye on the symptoms of that and make sure that that's not occurring. You may need to back down. Calcium carbonate, it doesn't get more simple than this. Double-blind trials, supplementation of 1,000 to 1,200 milligrams a day. This was done for 3 months, and this improved PMS symptoms, negative affect, water retention, and menstrual pain. Good to note that the lower dose, 480 milligrams, was not very significant. So probably necessary to use those higher doses in this case. Vitamin E was also studied. This was studied in women with fibrocystic breast changes. So if you have a woman with fibrocystic breast changes and interested in decreasing PMS symptoms, this might be a go-to for you. Higher doses appear to be somewhat more effective than low doses, but benefit was noted upon all of those. So generally somewhere between 200 and 400 is the good recommendation. So I included this on L-tryptophan for PMS, not just PMS. The study was actually using tryptophan and saw a significant improvement in women with PMDD. So there's a lot on this slide. The gist is they were using 2 grams 3 times a day, but they were using it with a meal, presuming that there was protein contained in that meal. So tryptophan is actually best administered and more effective on an empty stomach or along with carbohydrates. If you did that, you would likely need much less than the 2 grams 3 times a day that they were using. So nevertheless, very interesting because of that PMDD aspect. I think that's very significant. Caution here, because if you have patients on SSRIs, amitriptyline, you know, you are basically adding to that serotonin load. So you want to watch out for serotonin syndrome. You can use symptoms, of course, but neurotransmitter testing as well to make sure you're not pushing a patient into serotonin excess. Okay, so there are several studies supporting seed use in relation to reduction in symptoms of breast tenderness, but seed cycling, unfortunately, doesn't have any randomized clinical control trials yet, I hope one day. But this has been used in traditional medicine with great outcomes for many, many years. Again, we're likely thinking these freshly ground seeds are providing those lignans we talked about. The lignans bind excess hormones and remove them from the body in this second half of the phase. So we're using 1 to 2 tablespoons of flax or pumpkin seeds in that first half of the phase and then switching over in the second half of the phase to 1 to 2 tablespoons of sesame or sunflower, providing quite a few essential fatty acids, zinc, which helps to produce progesterone in that second half of the cycle. These may be all of the mechanisms why it works so well. And then hyperandrogenism. So if you see elevations in testosterone or DHEA on your hormone reports, think about this as a red flag, right? So you may see the notation here on the report saying the higher upper range DHEA and testosterone are suggestive of PCOS or metabolic syndrome, basically insulin resistance at the start. So you may look into serum vitamin D, fasting glucose, and insulin testing. So if you see these elevations in the saliva and you've tested blood and blood sugar looks great, hemoglobin A1C looks great, fasting insulin levels look great, beautiful. You know that you've caught this insulin resistance piece at a very, very early phase because you're going to see elevations in that those androgen levels in the saliva far prior to when you start seeing the movement in the serum. So that means this is just a great tool. You can use this, catch this way ahead of time, get on top of this, get a treatment protocol in place, and make sure that this, you know, never starts in the first place. It's a lot harder to treat once that snowball gets rolling. So this is alluding to PCOS, yes, so we'll dive into this. The most common endocrine disorder of reproductive age women. There are various numbers here, but I've run across 4 to 6% of women in the US alone. We typically think of PCOS women as being overweight or obese, but in fact, we see women of all shapes and sizes presenting with this disorder. So don't let that fool you. I think that's the number one most misunderstood aspect of PCOS. And then, again, you're looking out for that testosterone and DHEA levels in the saliva testing. Okay, so the hyperandrogenism is really what's responsible for a lot of the symptoms that you're experiencing. And interestingly, you know, it's the insulin resistance that's causing that hyperandrogenism in the first place. The insulin resistance is actually unique in PCOS. It doesn't look to be an issue with sensitivity of the insulin receptor sites or insulin resistance as we classically know it. It seems to be this post-receptor defect in the insulin-mediated signaling pathway. So it's happening after what we commonly think of. So conventional treatment of PCOS, that would be diet and exercise. And then metformin, Clomid, spironolactone, oral contraceptives. I won't go into a great detail there, but that's the conventional approach. So probably far and away number one treatment is going to be D-chiroinositol. This is a stereoisomer of myoinositol. It looks like that D-chiroinositol is actually deficient in women with PCOS. So we see double-blind trials supplementing D-chiroinositol and seeing a great improvement in the symptoms. So the studies, at least in this case, was using 1,200 milligrams per day. So again, I'm going to move through these quite quickly here. We've got a lot more information to cover. You will have access to all of this to refer back to, but here's again, just nutraceuticals that have been studied in improving PCOS. So we were talking about chromium, N-acetylcysteine, L-carnitine, CoQ10, and omega-3s. So here's a really nice holistic protocol that you might consider. We have a dietary implementation here. We have exercise, focusing on resistance training, again, to increase insulin sensitivity, and manage blood glucose. Using a botanical formula here that's listed out, and then D-chiroinositol, of course. Potentially berberine, and then optimization of vitamin D levels would be another approach. These are some wonderful botanical approaches. You can see that phytoest, we're supporting healthy estrogen levels in the first half of the cycle. In the second half of the cycle, phytoprogest, so it's helping to modulate correct amounts of progesterone. Vitamin D, that deficiency is very common in women with PCOS, so ensuring that adequate vitamin D levels are present. So here's the fun part, case study of Joy. She was a 25-year-old female. She's showing low estrogen and low progesterone, so potentially suggestive of anovulatory cycles, which PCOS has quite commonly. Upper range testosterone and DHEA, again, signifying to us potentially PCOS metabolic issues. And then an HPA axis dysfunction of phase one. So how did we treat Joy? Here that is listed out. We did seed cycling with her. We limited carbohydrate intake to less than 100 grams per day. That's not necessarily low, but Joy was eating a very standard American diet, very sad diet previous to this. So that was a huge shift for her. We utilized evening primrose oil, vitamin D. We made sure she had a cofactor combination support. You'll recall that chart previously showing you all those cofactors. We took all of those things and made sure they were in a combination formula here. We had her turn off all electronics by 9 p.m. She was one of those, like, I'm going to fall asleep to watching Netflix until 11 p.m. So we made sure to shift that for her. She was in bed by 9:30, getting 8 hours of quality sleep per night. We added in resistance training and a bit of yoga. Okay, so 8 months later, we see just an amazing change in her levels. She now looks to be ovulating because we see beautiful levels of estradiol. And look at that progesterone level, went all the way from 102 up to 325. So that's a huge shift. She's obviously feeling much, much better. Her testosterone level has dropped down quite a bit. She was upper range there on the first testing and is now in the normal zone. And then her DHEA level has come down quite a bit. Adrenal function is still a little low. She did improve in the morning. We're still working on that, but she's obviously much, much, much improved. Okay. So we don't want to forget about the men, right? Hormone imbalance is just as important for men, often overlooked. There are not as many controlled studies for men, so I'll move through these quickly here and leave you with this information to refer back to. In females, when we talk about insulin resistance, we're talking about upper range, you know, or elevated testosterone or DHEA. You see the exact opposite in men. So insulin resistance actually leads to lower testosterone, or actually low testosterone, suboptimal or low. So treatment protocols, finding new ways to relieve stress. This is not as easy, I think, for men to do than women. Nutritious diet, plenty of sleep, exercise, group support. So making sure that men have their tribe, right? It's not often the norm. It's not something that we readily take to as a society. Women are more, able to get together and kind of talk about these issues, whereas men don't often do that. And plenty of water. Okay, stress management, this is a huge part, both for men and women. Higher stress has been shown to decrease or drop off those testosterone levels. Okay, appropriate amounts of sleep. Obviously, a good night's sleep and good sleep hygiene has been associated with healthier androgen levels in men. The good news here, exercise. Exercise seems to be a great way to maintain testosterone levels as one ages. And all different types of exercise have been studied to show this improvement or this actual maintenance of testosterone. So slow movement exercises, things like Tai Chi, even short-term moderate intensity exercises, and weight resistance. So this means you get to pick the exercise program that fits your patient's lifestyle and their enjoyment. So, oftentimes, think that the exercise program that works is the one that the patient does, right? So in this case, it looks like testosterone levels are happy no matter what your patient is doing. So nutrition, we're going to eliminate or limit sugar. A lower glycemic index seems to be helpful. Eating healthy fats, and then a whole foods diet. There was a study done on branched chain amino acids, so whey protein and cheese, supportive of testosterone levels. And of course, this is all most effective when combined with exercise. Zinc in particular is required by the pituitary to release luteinizing hormone, which then stimulates the testes to produce testosterone. So oftentimes if you're finding testosterone formulas, they will always contain zinc because of the research done in this area. Zinc supplementation looks to improve the qualitative and quantitative attributes of semen, the number of sperm, mass motility, and fertility test numbers. Puncture vine is a botanical studied to improve free testosterone, estradiol, and DHT. Horny goatweed, rightly named, I assume. This is a great one to also stimulate testosterone production. And then saw palmetto. Saw palmetto has been shown to inhibit 5-alpha reductase activity. So 5-alpha reductase is the enzyme that takes testosterone and converts it into DHT. So this blocks that from happening, leaving more free testosterone available. And this has actually been shown to be as effective as finasteride without the loss of libido as a side effect. Super important to note there. Stinging nettle root has been studied to displace testosterone from the sex hormone binding sites, so it renders and leaves more free testosterone available to the tissues. So a nice holistic treatment protocol using zinc, of course, diethylmethane potentially, making sure the estrogen that is present in the man is actually being metabolized correctly to those, again, less carcinogenic byproducts. Rhodiola as an adaptogen, so supporting cortisol levels, energy levels, that stress response, stress modulation. B-complex, again, for the adrenal support. Also, the cofactor in many neurotransmitters as well. Increasing fiber intake, so something like DIM also helping to remove estrogen appropriately from the body. And then 20 minutes of weight-bearing exercise. Again, exercise of any sort is really also shown to be an improvement, so you can pick anything from there. So that might be a really good approach as a holistic program. And your adventure begins. I hope that was a great amount of information. Again, you'll have access to those slides to be able to go in, look at those studies and pull those dosages back when you need them. They should be at your right-hand side. Thank you everyone for joining me. I think we're gonna turn it over to questions. If you have any, feel free to chat those in and we'll get going.